Hi everybody, thank you for watching my video on physics. In this video, we shall discuss specific latent heat and demonstrate some numerical examples. Let's recall that latent heat refers to an object, such as a block of ice or a metal wing. Latent heat is the energy involved in a phase change without change in temperature. For a block of ice, the energy needed to melt the ice into water at 0 degrees Celsius is the latent heat of fusion of the ice block. Clearly, if a larger block is used, the latent heat is higher. Latent heat is useful for a particular object only. If we want to compare different materials, we need to use the same mass. This is why we need to define specific latent heat. In addition, the latent heat of fusion and the latent heat of vaporization for the same object may be different. Therefore, we have the following two terms, specific latent heat of fusion and specific latent heat of vaporization. Can you decide definitions for these two terms? Pause the video for a while and answer the question. Please press the spacebar to pause the video now and write down your answer. The specific latent heat of fusion of a substance is the energy required to melt 1 kg of the substance without a change in temperature. You may replace 1 kg by per unit mass. For example, the specific latent heat of vaporization is the energy required to vaporize per unit mass of the substance at a constant temperature. It is important to note that specific latent heat refers to a substance. Therefore, it is incorrect to say the specific latent heat of fusion of a beaker of ice. Instead, we should say the specific latent heat of fusion of ice. This is very similar to specific heat capacity. That is, we should not say the specific heat capacity of a beaker of water, but instead the specific heat capacity of water. In an experiment to find the specific latent heat of fusion of ice, we will not use exactly 1 kg of ice. Instead, we shall use an arbitrary amount of ice. Let's say we use m kilogram of ice. Then, if the energy needed to melt this m kilogram of ice is Q, then the specific latent heat of fusion is LF equal to Q divided by m. This is the mathematical definition of specific latent heat of fusion of a solid. Similarly, the specific latent heat of vaporization of a certain liquid is LV equal to Q divided by m, where Q is the energy required to vaporize m kilogram of the liquid. From the equation, the unit of specific latent heat is joule per kilogram. For example, if 23,900 joules of energy is needed to melt 26 grams of a solid at the melting point, the specific latent heat of fusion of the solid is 23,900 divided by 0.026 equal to 9.19 times 10 to the power 5 joule per kilogram. The table below shows the standard values of specific latent heat of water. Let's find how much energy is needed to convert 1 kg of ice at minus 50 degrees Celsius to steam at 150 degrees Celsius. Before we do any calculation, let's draw the heating curve. It involves 5 stages. 1. Heating the ice from minus 50 degrees Celsius to 0 degrees Celsius. 2. Melting the ice at 0 degrees Celsius. 3. Heating the water from 0 degrees Celsius to 100 degrees Celsius. 4. Boiling the water at 100 degrees Celsius. And finally, 5. Heating the steam from 100 degrees Celsius to 150 degrees Celsius. The calculation involves 5 pieces of data. The specific heat capacity of ice, the specific latent heat of fusion of ice, the specific heat capacity of water, the specific latent heat of vaporization of water, and the specific heat capacity of steam. The total energy needed is Q equal to m times C1 times delta T1 plus m times LF plus m times C2 times delta T2 plus m times LV plus m times CV times delta TV equal to 1 times 2100 times 0 minus minus 50 plus 1 times 3.34 times 10 to the power 5 plus 1 times 4200 times 100 minus 0 plus 1 times 2.26 times 10 to the power 6 plus 1 times 2100 times 150 minus 100 equal to 1105 kilojoule plus 334 kilojoule plus 420 kilojoule plus 2260 kilojoule plus 105 kilojoule equal to 3224 kilojoule or 3.22 times 10 to the power 6 joule. Let's compare the energy needed to vaporize water, Q1, to the energy needed to raise the water from 0 degrees Celsius to 100 degrees Celsius, Q2. The ratio of Q1 to Q2 is 2260 kilojoule to 420 kilojoule or 5.38. That is, Q1 equal to 5.38 times Q2. Although you often see heating curve as shown in figure 1, a more accurate heating curve of water should be redrawn as shown in figure 2. We have already learned that water has a very high specific heat capacity, so that it has a lot of applications, such as using as a coolant to carry away energy. From the above result, we know that the energy used to vaporize water is even more significant. For example, in fighting a fire with water, energy is absorbed from the heat source not just due to the high specific capacity of water, but also due to the much larger value of specific latent heat of vaporization. In other words, the potential energy of the molecules is as important as the kinetic energy of the molecules. Cooking food using steam is an efficient method. Can you explain why steaming is an efficient cooking method? Pause the video for a while and answer the question. Please press the space bar to pause the video now and write down your answer. In steaming food, the food is placed inside a chamber of steam. As steam condenses, it releases a huge amount of latent heat of vaporization to the food. Therefore, cooking by steaming is efficient. Let's look at a numerical example. If 1 kg of melting ice is mixed with 2 kg of water at 20 degrees Celsius, what is the final temperature of the mixture? Given the specific capacity of ice is 2100 joules per kilogram per degree Celsius, the specific heat capacity of water is 4200 joules per kilogram per degree Celsius, and the specific latent heat of fusion of water is 3.34 times 10 to the power 5 joules per kilogram. Solution. Since the temperature of melting ice is always 0 degrees Celsius, the initial temperature of ice is at 0 degrees Celsius. Assume that all the ice has been melted and the final temperature of the mixture is T. The change in ice involves two stages, melting and raising temperature. Therefore, the heat absorbed by the ice is Q1 equal to M1 times LF plus M1 times C1 times delta T1 equal to 1 times 3.34 times 10 to the power 5 plus 1 times 4200 times T minus 0. Equal to 3.34 times 10 to the power 5 plus 4200T. The heat released by the water as it is cooled is Q2 equal to M2 times C2 times delta T2 equal to 2 times 4200 times 20 minus T equal to 168,000 minus 84,000T. Assume that low heat is absorbed from the surrounding. By conservation of energy, Q1 equal to Q2, we have 3 times 34 times 10 to the power 5 plus 4200T equal to 168,000 minus 84,000T. So we have 88200T equal to minus 166,000. So T equal to minus 1.88 degrees Celsius. Wait, this is impossible because water cannot be at a temperature lower than 0 degrees Celsius. Please go through our calculation once again to find out what has gone wrong. Pause the video for a while and answer the question. Please press the spacebar to pause the video now and write down your answer. The culprit is our assumption that all the ice has been melted. If all the ice has been melted, the known as final temperature of the mixture is 0 degrees Celsius. The energy required to melt all the ice is Q1 equal to M1 times LF equal to 3.34 times 10 to the power 5 equal to 334,000 joules. The largest possible energy provided by the water is Q2 equal to M2 times C2 times delta T2 equal to 2 times 4200 times 20 minus 0 equal to 168,000 joules. Clearly, the energy provided by the water is not enough to melt all the ice. That's why our assumption that all the ice has been melted is incorrect. Instead, since Q1 greater than Q2, some ice remains unmelted. The final temperature of the mixture is 0 degrees Celsius. It is a mixture of ice and water. Question. The wind speed in a typhoon can be as high as 200 km per hour. This can cause serious damages. Can you explain the energy source of a typhoon? Be the first to write your answer in the comments below. You are welcome to comment on the answers of other people. I hope this video can help you understand more about specific latent heat. Thank you for watching.